For those who know the Gay Liberation Network, we're a multi-issue organization focusing not just on LGBTQ issues, but also international solidarity, defense of trade unionists, defense of racial minorities, and so forth. We focus on LGBT issues, but anti-war issues and concern, for example, over the blockade of Cuba has been one that many of our people have held dear to our hearts for a very long time. Those of you who know a little bit about the history of Cuba will know that Cuba has had some problems with the treatment of LGBT people, as the United States. One thing that probably a lot of people don't know is that trans people and intersex people can get free gender assignment surgery in Cuba, something that we don't even have free healthcare in this country yet, and we're a much larger and more wealthy nation. So, as I think Alberto will share with us tonight, Cuba still has many challenges in terms of fully recognizing LGBT equality, something our own country has as well. Before I give over the mic to Stan Smith, who helped organize tonight's event, I'd like to point out that we do have a literature in the rear there. We'd invite you to pick up the literature back there. While we're listening to the presentation by Alberto, I'd invite people to sign the Gay Liberation Network mailing list, which I'm going to start around the room here. And I would just ask that if you have questions or comments, to hold them to the end of Alberto's presentation. We will have an opportunity for questions and comments. I just ask you to keep them brief so that Alberto can respond to them. We are very privileged to have him come all the way from Cuba, and so I think we're mainly here to hear what he has to say, but obviously questions and comments are welcome as well. So with that, I'm going to give the microphone over to Stan. This is, I should note, tonight's presentation is being broadcast thanks to the good people at Chicago Access Network Television. While this microphone is not amplified, this will be broadcast later on CAN-TV, one of our city's most valuable public access resources. So a big shout out to CAN-TV. Let's give them an applause. And I'd also like to thank very much the good people of Nookie's Tree Restaurant, who, without any prompting from us, not only donated this space, but this wonderful spread over here. So let's give it up for Nookie's Tree Restaurant. So when you order food here, make sure to give your waiters or waitresses a good tip, right? Okay, I'm giving it over to Stan Smith here.
Thanks, Andy. I'm with the Chicago ALBA Solidarity Committee. The ALBA is the countries in Latin America, the progressive ones like Cuba, Venezuela, Ecuador, and Bolivia. And we organize different events to let people here in this country know about what's going on in those countries. We have a sign-up sheet if you're interested. In the fall, we'll be having events with some speakers on Honduras and Ecuador. But I want to say a little first about the U.S. has reestablished diplomatic relations with Cuba, but the U.S. blockade remains fully in effect, and so as well as the occupation of the Guantanamo by the U.S. military. Now, I spent 2 months in Cuba this summer, and I could see how this blockade affects the life of everybody there all day long. It's sort of like having to walk around all day with like a 40 or 50 pound bag of bricks on your back. It's just it's a constant drain and slows down everything in their lives, and it just wears the people down. And it's been going on for 55 years, and we really should try to do something to help end it. There's a bill in this flyer I handed out today. There's a bill in the Senate. Durbin has already signed on to it. If you'd call Kirk, it's on the back of this, tell him to sign on to this. sign on to end the blockade. Now, the blockade is sort of similar to, like I said, it's in the flyer. It said, Cuba has been singled out and punished by this blockade, just as gay people have been historically been singled out and punished for being gay. They are both vindictively punished simply for following their own paths of development. So this is really something we should try to put an end to as quickly as possible and get this boot off the back of the Cuban people. And in Cuba, like gays around the world, they've been subject to this public exclusion, public rejection, bullying and violence and suffering imposed upon their people, and subject to all sorts of slanders, which, you know, Alberto can address some of the stories we're hearing about gays in Cuba now. Now, he's a, Alberto Roque Guerra is an LGBT activist and has been published on gender theories, sexualities, and cultural and political aspects of gay and trans identities. He's worked closely with CENESEX, which is Cuba's National Center for Sex Education, with Mariel Castro, the daughter of President Raul Castro. He's written a number of articles, which I think are just in Spanish, right? Sexual Diversity in Cuba, A Human Rights Overview, Sexual Diversity in Revolutionary Times from 1959 to 2009. Those are just two of the examples. He's also been the founder and the past coordinator of Hombres por la Diversidad, an educational and advocacy group related to the National Center for Sex Education, CENESEX. He's been a member of the organizing committee for the National Day Against Homophobia and Transphobia in Cuba, which happens every May 17th. He was a member of the organizing committee from 2008 to 2012. He's a member of the National Commission for the Comprehensive Attention for Transsexual Persons. And he's been at conferences overseas and in Cuban universities, giving presentations on the subject of sexual diversity, gender, and sexual health. He's given workshops in many community organizations and even in the Tribunal Supremo de la República de Cuba, the Cuban version of their Supreme Court. He has a blog, if you can read Spanish. It's, I have the web address here on the back of this flyer. And we also have the interview I did with him in Cuba and the two interviews he did this week at WNUR and WBEZ, which I could send you if you want. So with that, oh, and one other thing, I have this t-shirt that the Vancouver committee sent for you, which they wore in their gay pride demonstration in Vancouver. The Vancouver committee actually sent more things than this, but I only have this now. It was, they'd been held up by U.S. Customs. Just like his visa was held up until day before he was going to come. It took three senators to calling in to the State Department to make sure he was given his visa. Which, if you know Art Heitzer, he is basically responsible for making sure that Alberto's here today. So Alberto, thank you for being here.
All right. First of all, I would like to appreciate Andy, Stan, Cristina Perez from Dominica University. Cristina, she's a sociologist and a scholar who invited me to come to Dominican and participate. She's like Madrina. It's like, you know, the author of this process that made possible other connections with people after the, because I was attending the ASA Congress, the American Sociological Association meeting in Chicago. So it's gonna be in Milwaukee tomorrow with Art Heitzer. I appreciate very much what he has done, his endurance, trying to make possible this visit. Let's talk then about what is sexual diversity in Cuba. This is a very probably pretentious title because it's a long presentation, so more than one conference to speak about that. So I will try to make a summary. And talking first about the history and the current challenges that we are facing concerning sexual diversity. When I'm talking about, next one, sexual diversity. It always happens. It always happens that on certain audiences. when I'm talking about sexual diversity, I'm also talking about this long term that is called non-heteronormative sexualities. Probably you're aware about that because the scholars, we are very complicated just inventing new terms, but it's a way of including not only sexual orientation identities and also gender identities, but also practices, way of you, the way you unite with other people, the way you build your own family, your friends, a community, is related to that. It's a broader spectrum concerning sexuality and gender. Of course, this is a new concept, relatively new from the 90s, but it's very useful just to speak about other determinants that are related to sexual orientation and gender, like racial issues, like ethnicity, another point that we're gonna speak about them about at the end. Next. Well, this guy that was, you know, handsome, he represents a masculinity, the way we interpret that in an island of the Caribbean, that is machismo. Machismo is present in all societies. In Western society, you have different colors. There is a way of expressing machismo that is a neo-machismo that is very subtle. But it's still very, very strong. And in Cuba, we are not an exception. You will see how our history has been very, very strongly influenced by machismo as a source of all the problems concerning discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. The Cuban flag was there because it's the nation birth was tightly related to these macho ideas, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna mention briefly few examples of what happened before 1959 with the triumph of the revolution, and in a way trying to explain why we are like that, or why our history, our recent history is being like that. In the 18th centuries were the first records of what is happening, was happening. We were a colony of Spain. You're aware about that. And since up to the 19th century, the homosexuality was classified as pederast. And the nation formation is located around the 19th century, is the perception of being Cuban as an identity. To have a Cuban way of thinking different to the Spain, to the colony, because we were Spain at that moment, overseas Spain, although in Spain they do not call like that. It was more for English-spoken people, overseas territories or things like that, or French also when they were an empire. They call overseas territory their colonies. So what we are living now in Cuba is a post-colonial way of thinking, because we're part of this colonial issue and we still inherited a lot of discriminatory issues from that period. Next. Benjamin de Césped was a colleague, a doctor, and medicine classified homosexuality as a disorder. This was presented, is a summary of an article and research that Benjamin de Césped presented in about the prostitution in the city of Havana. It is quoted from the year 1888, and he said that this was homosexuality, he meant, it was not called like that, was an enormous degradation of human nature, and that is sickening the Cuban society, and also it's very interesting that he's complaining about many pederasts around Havana. Be very interesting. But he was not speaking about Cuban pederasts. He was speaking about Spanish and Spaniards who were pederasts. So he was blaming the Spanish empire of homosexuality that was present in Cuba at that moment. Do you know that the term homosexuality, when it was created or coined for the first time?
19th century.
Yep, 19th century. When? 1869. Remember, Stonewall was 1969, mm-hmm. 100 years before homosexuality was coined by a writer from Hungary, and later it was very fastly introduced by medicine as a mental disorder in 1870 by a neurologist, right? It was a disorder since that moment. It was a way of controlling bodies and those who were not fitting with heterosexual norm. And not all also but for controlling them, but to cure them, to have people accessible for the economy of the development of capitalism. Okay, this was part of this issue at that moment with in the modern area. Next. In Cuba before the Republic, also we have a lot of expression more than the medicine did. In our history, in our wars against the Spanish Empire, they were people fighting against it that were very brave, but they were homosexual, some of them. And there is some records of these people that were pretty brave, but they were fearless, but again, they have that problem of looking in an effeminate way. So they were not actually good Cubans because of that. Regardless, they were very good at the battlefield. It happened in the Cuban nation formation, and it was during the whole 20th century, and even during the revolution, if you were a homosexual, you were not a good Cuban. Or you were not, you could not speak about the nation in a way that the proud and the pride of that most Cuban should do. You are a second-class citizen, right? That's the way it was considered. I call it the period the Bourgeois Republic. You know, the 1902 was the U.S. government intervention in Cuba, and we thought we were free, finally, but it was not like that. Actually, with the U.S. intervention, all the governments were following what the Washington said, and also the cultural influence was so strong that Cuba changed definitely in a very radical manner. And, you know, fashion, the way of consumerism that we had, everything was changes in the modern Cuban nation after 1920s and 1930s. Immediately, there was a campaign by the media against pepillitos and garzonas. Garzonas was the term for speak about lesbian, or those women who were very masculine, because it comes from French, like garçon, it means boy, is that right? And pepillitos, it's funny, I was to this kind of mind, that as you can see, there is a lot of gender transgressions in the way he's wearing his attires, his outfit, his the way he comb his hair, and look at all these hands pointing, saying you are pretty weird, you are pretty freak. Can I say that? You're so rare. So La Semana made a publications complaining about these guys that were seeking again Cuban society. But they said that it was important for abroad from the US influence and the European influence as well. We are complaining, blaming other people over wrong things all the time, sometimes. This is a problem. Next one. No, there is, this, again in La Semana, look at that. There is a transgender nowadays, if you look at that person. It was the 1927. For those people who are there, this person, I don't know if it's she or he, we suppose that it's a man, are wearing this female-looking attire. Attire or outfit? I think there are synonyms. All right. And this gentleman is saying, I'm an honor to talk to Mr. Menendez's daughter or Mr. Menendez's son. Right? Next. For the first time in Cuban history, there was a debate on the media. The woman on the right, on the left hand, Mariblanca Saba Aloma, was a left-wing feminist, very outstanding feminist in Cuba during that years. She wrote a lot of articles, lit books, and a lot of people still speaking about Sabas Aloma. Being a feminist in Cuba in 1928, she should be very brave. But she was against lesbians, garzonas again. And the debate with this doctor, she was a doctor, Flora Diaz Parral. She said, all society believes change. That's quite important. I believe that a garzona is a sort of transition from the woman of 1914 after the First World War. That, you know, after any wars, I think the way of thinking is changing everywhere, to the woman of the future. She, for the first time, in my opinion, she was speaking about gender fluent approach from that perspective, that gender could be changed, that something can be modified. It's not a national issue. But she said, of the left-wing feminists, that women were rotten of masculinity and threatened civilized progress. And they cannot infertile. Infertile? So again, your gender expressions are related to reproduction. They do not have any kids, you know, any babies. The situation changed radically in 1959. That's, you know, just talking just to the current moments, we had a socialist revolution. But by the way, the revolution is a process that is after 1959, right? Because many people think the revolution ended in 1959. It's not done yet. It's something that is in a process that is changing all the time. And I will try to organize my presentation now by decades, because they have changes and characteristics that can be located for very, very specific issues. So during the socialist revolution, I think that we have new subjectivities, and nowadays we're speaking about the rainbow nation dream, a nation with a lot of diversity, with a lot of heterogeneity of people. Next. The 1960s were a radical moment that changed everything in Cuba. Women's rights were recognized for the first time ever in a very broad spectrum. They occupied public spaces. They were part of, they became professionals. Prostitution was actually in a lower rates in Cuba very fastly. Most of prostitutes, or what you call now sex workers, for me it's a liberal concept, came back to the society. They were in certain society. And in the 60s also, we have a very complex political situation. The US blockade against Cuba was established in that decade, and a lot of confrontation between governments was immediately established. But also the Soviet Union and the Cold War was on the way, was approaching to Cuba. We had the blockade, a very bad economical and political situation. And also, it's very interesting that the main three political, left-wing political organizations and party that were part of the process of changes in Cuba, the predominant ideology was from the Communist Party. Our Communist Party was highly, strongly influenced by Stalinism. Vladimir Ilyich Lenin decriminalized homosexuality in 1919. And Joseph Stalin recriminalized it again in 1934. Was the moment when gulags were created, and he sent a lot of people to these concentration camps, but they were punished by the law at that moment, all right? This influence was worldwide, in all socialist countries that were appearing at that moment in the socialist bloc, and also for the Cuban communist. Cuban communists, machismo, a lot of prejudice, a high literacy rates in Cuba. There was no sexual education at that moment. Medicine persisted considering homosexuality a disorder or an illness. So everything contributed to the highly and deeply homophobia that we have in the 60s, in my opinion. And also we have the new mind ideology. Let me tell you that the new mind is based on what Che Guevara said about the man of the future for a communist society. He didn't mention gender, he didn't mention anything related to homosexuality. What happened applying this was a distortion of what Che Guevara meant about the new man. I can give you, can provide a lot of information about that and look for you to look forward, even in English, about what Che Guevara said about the new conciencia and the new man. But actually the way things were very radical, and they were officials and many people in Cuba were trying to erase our past. We were not actually ready for that, such a change, a huge change, and the situation was pretty bad at that moment concerning sexualities and gender. In the meantime, we were moving forward in other things that were pretty good for the Cuban society. Next one. And 1966, this is the Juventud Rebelde, still exists in Cuba. It's a newspaper for the youth. It represents the interests of the Young Communist League in Cuba. There was a speech of this guy. He was the principal of the organization, the president, and he said, homosexuality, at that moment they called homosexualism, like a system, like socialism or capitalism. Yeah. Well, probably he thought it was an ideology like machismo or something, but it's, you know, requires a specific approach. Homosexuals should not be graduated from university. A communist saying that, for you probably, but it was the 60s, right? And he said, we need to repudiate and to become this crowd into antisocial and individuals. So, and he also said that we were degenerated. Okay, plus that. So this was the approach that justified during at the beginning of what happened at the universities, a lot of homosexuals were fired from the university, and some others were prohibited to go in if they say they were openly homosexual. But also if it was suspected that you were a homosexual, a process was around you concerning this. So this is even before UMAPS. Next one. Because there were also a lot of persecution on the streets. People were wearing in the 60s, you remember perfectly well, the Beatles, the rockers, the influence from the American music that at the beginning was prohibited in Cuba that year. And people wearing these outfits actually were considered gay, were considered homosexuals. And in the newspaper, they said that the American dream was destroyed and the boys from the fourth world, they said, will you like this for your son? And also, the cure, providing education through work. And this is something that was announcing what happened later. Next one. During the military units to aid production. Work was considered a cure, was considered a wave of having a new man in Cuba. It's very important to say that they are not speaking about the new woman. It was supposed that they were included. At that moment, we don't have any gender approach about the way we speak, right? And this is they are forging useful citizens for the society. Besides, they were also persecuting homosexuals. They were concentrating these people in the military units. In Cuba, going to the army was compulsory for all young people, male people. Now women are able to go if they wanted to go. We have a lot of military units for women there. And they're volunteering, going there, and they love that. It's very interesting. It's part of women's liberation as well. But it was obligated. They were obligated to go there because it was the army. And we were in the middle of the war with a lot of U.S. attacks, terrorist attacks that we suffer, the blockade, and a very, very, very heated political situation. Can I say that? Right. So, but the homosexuals were sent to these camps to work for production because of most of non-homosexuals, students, young people, young male, were in the army getting ready for a possible war that is was on the way because there was of belligerence between both governments. And also religious people, artists, writers, and people who were homeless, like they, no homeless, actually they were not working, lazy people, can I say that, unemployed people, were also sent to these units to be useful to the society we were building at that moment. This was actually, it lasted like 3 years from 1965 to 1968. Fidel Castro in person ordered to close the units, because it was a distortion of the initial idea. Nowadays, we have part of the army working in production. When you are going to the military, service, they work for production. In time of peace, this is the way it is called. They got military training, but also they provide their help, their contribution to production of agriculture, industries, and so on, right? It happens today, but it's not for homosexuals or certain people, it's for everyone. Now, if you say you are a homosexual, if you said that before, you were not, they said, okay, you're not ready to go to the military units. Many people did it, right? To say, I'm a homo, don't go to the army. So, but now if you say, okay, what's fine, what's the problem with that? Go in. Okay, Fidel was explaining during an interview with Ignacio Ramonet in 2006 about what he considered, this is very briefly, this explanation is pretty good. He said several students from their universities and young workers were recruited by the armed forces. I'm reading for the people. Do you see what is here on the slides? I think you don't. And homosexuals and women were not accepted by the army. There was a strong resistance against homosexuals with a significant macho meaning, right? And then, next. The slides is gonna come later. You will see what he said about the UMAPs during that interview to La Jornada newspaper, okay? Just hold the information there. In 1971, after UMAPs, the first National Congress on Education and Culture discussed actually homosexuality again, saying it was a complex disease and with a serious social impact. And repudiation is higher at all levels of the society. This was the grounds that permitted the state officials to ban, to prohibit homosexuals to work in education and culture, artists. I mean, both issues. I was pretty strong in my opinion. Sorry? No. It's never been a problem, a big problem. It happens, still homophobia in a healthcare setting. I can answer that later, but not in the healthcare. It was homophobia like anywhere, they didn't discuss about that here. And I've met a lot of my medical professors that were openly gay and they didn't suffer such a discrimination. It could happen from any official that said, okay, I see you so queer or weird, and you're not allowed to work here. It could happen still. But at that moment, it was for artists and also for people, teachers, working in education at all levels, because they were a bad example for the youth. They were a threat for the youth, as they said at that moment. Let's remind in the US history, that in 1973, homosexuality was removed from the list of mental disorders by the American Psychiatric Association, ALBA, right? I remind you as well that in the 60s and even the 70s, homophobia was pretty bad in this country as well. The movement that appears, the difference with Cuba, was at the beginning a left-wing movement. Some of the founders, even Matachin Society prior to that, was member of the Communist Party. And it was a very anti-war, anti-systemic movement, and very radical movement, the LGBT movement in the 60s and the 70s in the States. But from Cuba, the left-wing perspective, homosexuality was a threat from the capitalist society. You look at the interpretation in countries which are neighbors, a different approach both countries had state homophobia, state-sponsored homophobia. It was illegal in many states. In Florida, homosexuality was decriminalized in 2003. And in Cuba, it was in 1997. I will tell you later about the legal issues, right? Just to put that in the, in context, right? And then Fidel, in the interview to the Jornada newspaper, said that he acknowledged that it was an injustice and accepted all responsibility. I do not agree with Fidel. It was not only his responsibility. He was in charge of the country, and yes, he's responsible, but not the only one. The situation is very complex. You cannot say blaming. He was the guy who did a lot of wrong things as a human being. Actually, he explains in the interview I showed before that he had a lot of homosexual friends. He supported that. He supported them. But actually, this was his approach on that. And he acknowledged all the responsibility, and he acknowledged it was a mistake. Next one. In 1972, let me tell you that the policies that was in the Congress I mentioned before against artists and teachers lasted like 5 years period. We call in Spanish quinquenio gris, or the gray 5 years period. Quinquenio doesn't exist in English, I guess, for those who speak English. Quinquenio, does it exist? 5 years period, all right. So because they realized it was a mistake, the Ministry of Culture was finally created, and the policies changed a little bit, not that in a radical way. But many teachers and artists were able to come back. Some others did not recover at all from these discriminatory policies, and it's a pity, actually. And they actually feel a lot of pain nowadays because of that. Some others did it successfully and are working, and now they are very well recognized as teachers and artists and intellectuals in Cuba, and they're openly or not gay, and they express the way they are. In 1972, the National Work Group on Sexual Education was created. This was the initial core of CENESEX. CENESEX, the National Center for Sex Education, was created in 1988. After this group, Vilma Espingue, you are here in the middle, was one of the. She was a founder, and she coordinated that group. She passed away like 5-7 years ago. Was Raúl Castro's wife, and Mariela Castro's mother, of course. And she created from the. She was the president of the Cuban Women Federation, and she also were in charge of sexual education. At the beginning, it was more focused on a biological aspects of reproductive medicine, most of the times. Abortion was legal in Cuba since 1965. It was only to be done in institutions, hospitals, right? It was stated from that moment. Although before that, Cuba was an abortionist country compared to other countries of the region. I need to highlight that abortion was illegal in the whole region, and it was legal in Cuba at that moment. And also all reproductive rights for women were recognized, but I'm talking about heterosexual women. Let's speak about lesbian later, right? Next. In 1979, a bestseller that was called Man and the Woman and Their A Man and Woman and Their Intimacy from the former Democratic German Republic was published. And it says, homosexuality is not a disease, but a simple variant of human sexuality. The 70s, huh? It's very revolutionary. Homosexuals do not suffer from homosexuality, but rather from society discrimination and abuse. It was a bestseller, and it was everybody was looking for that. I just checked the part of homosexuality to see if I was ill or not. I was a kid at that moment, right? So, I'm fine. But in the 70s also, the country was part of, the constitution was, the socialist constitution was in 1976, and you'll see later that it was stated that marriage is a union between a man and a woman, and also in the during the constitution, there were other things that were not covered concerning sexualities and gender in a general approach. I think it was impossible at that moment. The 80s came, and we have Mariel Exodus. For people who are not aware about Cuban history, there was a confrontation between two governments. The people, some Cubans assaulted the Peru embassy in Havana, and the Cuban state, Fidel Castro, ordered to remove all the guards, all the security guards from that embassy, and a lot of people went into the embassy. And it was a migratory crisis, very, very bad migratory crisis. A lot of people were inside the embassy. Homosexuals who suffer from a lot of discrimination had the opportunity to leave the country. Some others that were in jail or they were in their communities were pushed to leave the country. I've met both people, people who were pushed and they did it. They went to Florida, most of them, and some others that remained in Cuba and didn't want it to go abroad. And there they are living their own lives, but they remember very well that actually they were pushed by some, guards and the police and all that. There was a lot of demonstration saying, out, you scum. Scum? All right, escoria. And things like that. Carter, Jimmy Carter, remember Giron, Bay of Pigs, yeah. Right? It was the environment. Also, the first case of AIDS was diagnosed, so we'll see that in details later. This is a sanatorium, the first one in Santiago de Las Vegas, in Havana. And the first sex reassignment surgery was done in 1988. This is Mavi Suzette, the first transsexual person who underwent surgery in Cuba. This is a documentary in the wrong body based on Mavi Suzette's story. You go to YouTube and you'll find there, everything's in YouTube. Okay. All right. Yeah. Oh, talking about Mariel again, go back. Do you know what most of the Cubans that were here from the 50s said about the people arriving to Mariel? Castro is sending the N-word people. N-word people. They said that word, I cannot say that. And faggots to Miami. This is wrong. He's invading, and he just get rid of these people. They said so when they arrived here. They were located by churches and many other institutions. I recommend you Susana Peña book that is called Oye Loca, like this, with Cuban intention. Oye Loca, that it speaks about what these people faced when they arrived to the States. It's very interesting, because it was a different color of discrimination, but they were discriminated. They have medical surveillance, they have medical follow-up, and they also were, they have their own community trying to survive with the Cuban identity in Miami. Most of them, although they were distributed from the whole country. Next. And the National Center for Sex Education was created, that's the way it is now. It's a great building. In 1988, and it was, actually, it's run by the state, it belongs to the Ministry of Health. It's an institution devoted to sexual education, dedicated also to promote and to make advocacy work for sexual rights nowadays. And with a lot of fields, it's not only for gay, lesbian, transgender people, they have created spaces, as we'll explain later, but also they work with teenagers, they work with the violent issues, they work with people who were victims of sexual child abuse. They have a lot of fields, gender approach, gender and healthcare. and community work also, promoting these initiatives based on the health, sexual health policies in Cuba. Next. So, I will very fastly explain about AIDS. Before the first case was diagnosed in 1985, we had a National AIDS Commission before that, because we were ready for that because of the first cases that were diagnosed here. I think it was in San Francisco, isn't it?
Yeah.
Of the first cases. And in Cuba, the first case, it was not a homosexual person, was a military soldier who was working in Mozambique, and he was straight. I hate the term straight, heterosexual, because I'm not twisted. And so, it's actually he was the first case, and after that, of course, it was spreading, but the government kept silent about it, right? At that moment. The first case died. Next one. I think it was, it wasn't the other. And the first case died. Also, I think it was 1986. It's there. Oh, right, 1985. And he was a choreographer, gay, that came to New York City. And it was published on the media, right? Then, and in 19, next one, okay. Antiretroviral treatment as a monotherapy started in 1987. I'm aware that you had a lot of problems with Reagan administration, and a lot of people died with the Federal Drugs Administration saying that this treatment was forbidden for Americans. And a lot of people died, mainly in San Francisco area, in New York City, in big cities, where a lot of people were gentrified, a gentrification process of the gay neighborhoods. So, in Cuba, we started in 1987, and the first case of pediatric HIV was detected in 1989. Mandatory sanatorium policy, that it was since the very beginning. Let me tell you that sometimes you can call that imprisonment, but actually sanatorium quarantine is part of the any epidemics. When you don't know what it is, you put people isolated from the rest of the society. That's what our healthcare system did. They didn't know how, many people thought that touching another people was what was transmitting the disease. Actually, in my opinion, they delayed a lot since the first case in 1985 up to 1993 to have mandatory sanatorium policy. Although in the late years of the 1980s, people were able to go out accompanied by a nurse, most of the cases, but it was, the government in Cuba was criticized. Conditions inside the sanatorium were amazing. Many people kept living there because they have better life standards, conditions, access to food, housing, everything for free. So many people, and I knew people, there is a movie about it, that got infected, were not homosexuals, were rockers, got infected. What's the name of the movie? Los Vikis. No, it's a movie that they got infected with HIV to go to live in the sanatorium because conditions were better. It happened in Cuba. Yeah. You never get bored in Cuba, actually. Next one. It's pretty bad what I said, but it happened. And from 1998 to 2003, men who had slept with men prior, Proyecto HSH, was created. Focusing in prevention, it was important because the epidemic became very fastly in a transmissible disease by sex, and men are responsible of this transmission. Next one. This is statistics of AIDS from 1986, since the beginning of the epidemic, to 2014. These are the total cases, and under antiretroviral treatment are 12,000. And 26, is that right to say that? Yeah. Right? So the 65.8% of the whole population who are HIV positive. Another issue, okay, deceased people, 3,060 something, is 16.7%. Okay? Next. This pie represents that HIV positive are men who have sex with men, 81%, and only 19% for women. And a recent study, a recent survey, demonstrated that from 9% of people who declare themselves they were men who have sex with men, I'm talking about sexual practices, I'm not talking about identities, right? This is an epidemiological term, and not an MSM, I'm more than that, fortunately, right? So, and they declare at the beginning of the year, many years ago, it was 90% of people. From 12 years old to, I think it was 12, to 55 years, I guess. Now it increased up to 21%. So people are not more, they're not afraid anymore to say, I have these sort of practices. We knew we have an iceberg process there, that the most of the population who declared themselves men who have sex with men were not in the statistics. Okay, that's the point I want to clarify here. Next. Also, in Cuba, it's very good in the policy, mother to child HIV transmission is zero. This is something we made it because we have a very, very tight follow-up of pregnant women. The state are not allowed, it's legal to say, don't get pregnant if you are HIV positive, right? You counsel, you say all the risks that you're facing, but the body of women are respected, right? But okay, they do prenatal HIV testing to sexual partners every 3 months. Lifelong combined antiretroviral treatment, regardless the CD4 count, immunological and virological follow-up during pregnancy, cesarean delivery and breastfeeding avoidance, as part of the process, and prophylactic antiretroviral treatment to the child when it's born, right? That's the main issues of why we succeeded as a country concerning it. It was recognized by the UN. Next. So prevention is quite important, and it's the cornerstone, of the HIV transmission prevention and to stop the epidemic. Counseling services, also education to target population, mainly on those groups who are vulnerable, more in men who have sex with men. On television, the media, in general, is increasing awareness about that finally, because if you check out the television, probably you might think in Cuba that the epidemic was transmitted by heterosexual men and women. They didn't speak about it. Now they're doing more and more in a very open way. Finally, in soap operas, people who are HIV positive and gay have voices. At the beginning, they were like not speaking and things like that. That were pretty weird. They can speak, you can know what they think about it, and it's pretty good. So education to general population is also very important. Next one. Also, this project of men who has sex with men was the first group run by the state that existed in Cuba advocating for changes, and also through education and counseling, related more to this target population and with this sort of sexual practices. They also included some trans individuals, as you can see here, and now the trans project is an independent project. They are working with men, but not necessarily with the same focus, because they have different practices, although most of them are biological men. Mm-hmm. Next one. And also during the special period came. Special is we are talking about a very hard moment for Cuba. Okay, the socialist bloc fell. It was called by some people the end of history, and things like that. It was like the. It was very funny, yeah. But also we had a very hard crisis, and it was the moment where Cuba was fighting to survive. The U.S. government blockade was harder with Torrey Shelley Act still in force, and also Helms-Burton Act still in force about the blockade. So the people became a little bit more tolerant to certain sexual expressions. Finally, trans people were on the streets, much more visible, and they were part of the, you know, celebrating in some, during, in Cuba we have a lot of political celebrations. One of them are for the Comité de Defensa de la Revolución, the Committees for the Defense of Revolution. And every 28th of September, the 28th, people have parties in their street, in the corner, with a lot of fire and things like that. As nothing happened there, we don't have anything to eat. The trans people were having as drag queens acting for the general population. It was so funny. And they read the whole statement saying patriot, you know, slogans and all that. Absolutely cross-dressing. It was very interesting. And this is a period who needs a very deep study of what happened at that moment. Still is something that we haven't researched very carefully, and it's very interesting. Strawberry and Chocolate, for you probably you're aware about this movie, was an Oscar nominee movie. As a foreign film, and this guy is a revolutionary left wing, but very, very orthodox. And this guy is gay, but very, very Cuban, and he loves the country and the nation. Ideological, they were not able to talk, and he was gay and he was straight, but they were able to negotiate to have an understanding. And this is the main message from the movie. It was very important in changing Cuban people's mind concerning sexuality and other gender expressions. The trans people were in the street more and more, and it's the way it is. It's very common here in Chicago as well. I've been in several cities in the States and in Europe, and I've seen a lot of the downtown area, a lot of trans people walking, not only here in Boys Town. So, and also lesbians were much more visible, but still they are hidden because they suffer from double discrimination for being women, and machismo is very strong, and also for being lesbians. And also, this is Micallito Beach. It's not exactly a gay beach, but a lot of gay people are going there. In summer now, there you can find families, heterosexual families, everybody sharing the same spaces, a lot of dogs, kicks walking around, also sex workers. It's very, very, it's like a carnival actually, it's very interesting to if you wanna meet Cuba, go there. And it's very, they're openly, the police at the beginning were harassing people, but now it's safer, huh? Micallito is like 20 minutes from Havana Center. You said, I wanna go to Micallito, but it's a very safe. It's probably that all your stuff won't be stolen if you stay there, no problem. It's very tolerant. And actually it's much more visible, all kind of people there, with different sexualities. It reminds me of the beach I visited here on, what's the name?
Hollywood Beach.
That's a beach. The difference is that I could smell marijuana. In that case, please chop, don't edit that what I'm saying here. Actually, next. Actually, from Senesex, my partner and I, my partner's name is Camilo Garcia Lopez Trigo. We've been together for 17 years. We started on a web prior by InsaneSex on a sexual diversity website with a lot of sections on news, sexual diversity, opinion of people. It was like a sort of forum, people exchanging opinion with censorship, without censorship, not at all. People even that were misspelling things, and I kept it that way just to show their level, you know. And a lot of exchange about sexual diversity. Even people from churches and religious people wrote there and sent a lot of opinions against homosexuality. We were evil and things that we should be cured, things like that. We were talking about AIDS also. We're announcing events. And we have another section that is a movie discussion group that takes place every month. I will explain later, right? About sexual diversity. Next. Advocacy work was increasing more and more, mainly in the websites for informal leaders. This is the blog from Paquito el de Cuba. It's very famous. You can find it on the internet very easily. And Negra Cubana Tenía Que Ser. She's a black feminist with a decolonial approach on feminism. It's very interesting, I love her. we do not agree most of the times, but many times, not most of the time, but she was criticizing me because I'm pro-queer, and she's supposed to, yeah, we have many things in common. Look, you're not aware about that, probably. And Proyecto Arcoiris is also a group, there is a network, independent, is not working with the state, although they support most of the state initiatives concerning the fight against homophobia. Are you tired? Are you tired? Are you bored? I can go faster. And this is my blog, ProQueer. That also is new because I have another in Blogspot that is called Homo Sapiens. Homo Sapiens or Sapiens? Homo Sapiens. It's Homo Sapiens. And then it's, speaking there, I just try to post scientific information because I also am a member of the Cuban Society for Multidisciplinary Studies of Sexuality. And also the things related, articles related to advocacy work and what we are doing against homophobia and other discriminatory grounds. There is a list here of the blogs in Cuba that are dedicated to sexual diversity and against homophobia, okay? A lot of them, and it's increasing and increasing, and we are interconnected. It's a way, what happened with the police yesterday? And we are just sending information, making advocacy work, sending open letters to high officials from the state and the parliament. Open letters are very powerful. probably if we don't have any response, at least they are aware that it's a group of people who are advocating for rights and changes in a very respectful way. And sometimes we could sound very radical in our opinions, but we do it in a very respectful way, in a dialogue-based approach. Yes? Yeah, actually, if you go to www.cubavacuba.cu, you can find them, all of them. And if you go to Proyecto Arcoiris, Arcoiris is Rainbow Project, you can find this list. Paquito as well. I don't have this list, I have to put it in my blog, but it's I'm connected with them anyway. Next. And the advocacy groups for sexual rights based on sex is the institution. This is was the first one. It was for trans people that it was founded in 2001. Next, it was a lesbian group, very, very interesting, that is called OREMI, and they have a national network working together for lesbians and trans people. Not together, but in different groups. I don't like that. I like more fluent connection between gender and sexualities. This is the group of Jóvenes por la Diversidad that are college students from different, several sexual orientations and gender that are working in advocacy work and education at the universities. We were not able to go into the elementary school or high school yet because the educational system in Cuba is very resistant on this aspect still, unfortunately. Remember, this is what is called by Foucault a biopower, the same as medicine and the same as the legal institutions. This is biopower, power around the body and life. And Humanidad por la Diversidad, the former group that I founded, that it was called before Hombres por la Diversidad, Men for Diversity. Humanidad means mankind for diversity. Is that right to say that?
Humanity.
Humanity for diversity. At the beginning, we were 12 apostles, men. And after 3 months, we were 40 members, including lesbians, heterosexual women, and trans people, and heterosexual men as well, right? Was increasing. We had like a human rights approach since the very beginning, and also erasing differences between identities more and more. Proyecto Arcoiris, I have mentioned before. Next, that is not belong to the institution, they're doing themselves. IDAHOT, International Days, the acronym for International Day Against Homophobia and Transphobia, IDAHOT. It was created because in May the 17th, the World Health Organization removed homosexuality from the list of illnesses, right? It was May the 17th, 1990. In 2003, a group in France and in Montreal were doing this, had this initiative, celebrating this, and this is what we do in Cuba. We have probably you see that, you say, oh, they have gay pride parades. We are not showing our pride. We are showing our outrage because we are discriminated. And we are inviting people to share that. And also, we share also initiative concerning to unite people against all discrimination, regardless of their sexual orientation and gender identity. That's what we do. A lot of celebrations take place there, like debates, also a lot of cultural activities, drag queen shows, books readings. Can I say that? Lecturas de libro, book readings, books presentation on sexual diversity, a lot of activities. It takes place mainly in Havana, but in the whole country. And every year we change the main, what do you say that? The main activities in provinces. We move to those provinces who are in more, you know, vulnerable situation concerning LGBT people, because we have differences as everywhere else. Compare what is happening in urban cities, urban areas, and rural areas. There is a difference between that. The same has happened here. So let's go back to history briefly concerning the law. As I said, it was in the colonial period, the crime of pederasty. Two examples: in the 17th century, the Holy Inquisition sentenced 18 effeminate men to jail. They were from Spain, of course. And they were confined to Cayo Puto, or Isla de las Mujeres, in the Bay of Havana. It was the only trial the Holy Inquisition celebrated in Cuba. The only one. And in the 19th century, Enriqueta Faber actually was a biological, he was a biological woman that was called himself Enrique Faber. He was a cross-dresser. It was able for him in Europe, in Switzerland, to study medicine. He joined Napoleon troops, and then she came to Cuba as a doctor, as a male doctor, as Enrique Faber, and she was in Baracoa, in the eastern part of Cuba. There, she got married with Juana de León, and after 2 years living together, Juana de León discovered that she was a he. And then she was sentenced to exile and 12 years in prison. She finally died in New Orleans, right? This is part of our history. In my opinion, it was a gender transgression, what she did. I don't know if it was lesbian, because these terms, these labels, didn't exist at that moment. The law that at that moment didn't find anything to condemn Enrique Faber, Enriqueta, it's better to say. She was a missionary, and she made a lot of things in Mexico after leaving Cuba, and then she died in New Orleans. And then in Cuba, it's also remained illegal homosexuality up to 1979, and it was removed, the article that stated that it was illegal. But another article persisted to persecute the homosexual, considering then a danger for society. Next. It was decriminalized in 1979, and the Article 76 and 94, the law of social dangerousness, was used to pursue homosexuals, right? It kept the same during the 80s, the 70s, as I explained before. It was supported by the law. So, next one. In 1987, we moved backwards again, and homosexuality was recriminalized, and it was classified as a public scandal, but only if you show homosexuality in public. Not if you had sexual relations with a man or a woman, same sexual relations, or in a group if you like to, in private. Finally, in 1997, the Penal Code removed homosexuality absolutely, and sexual child abuse was equally penalized regardless the offender victim gender identities. Before that, if the relation between the offender and the victim were of the same sex, the penalties were higher. The sentences were higher in years, and it was discriminatory. This is outrageous, because of most of these issues happen. These abuses happen, are perpetrated by heterosexual abusers. It's been everywhere, not only in Cuba, But it was changed finally in 1997. It was removed, and now it's the same, right? Next. But also, legally speaking, we have the first law that included and mentioned sexual orientation as a source of discrimination, and it was the labor code or labor law in Cuba that it passed 2 years ago. We activists were, recruiting efforts. We were fighting, sending letters to Mariela Castro, that she's a member of the parliament. She's a congresswoman, and she made a brilliant explanation of what gender identity is. Sexual orientation passed, but gender identity was not accepted to be passed. So they included gender, sexual orientation, color of skin. Let me tell you that they had here sex, and we promoted gender, because we don't consider sex as a determinant of discrimination. It's gender, right? And color of the skin, instead of saying race, because race do not exist. This is a cultural construct. What you see is the color of the skin. Let me tell you, I'm white for Cubans, right? And this is something that is still is present and is related. All these sources of discrimination are related between them. And also, where did not pass gender speech, gender identity, and violence on the workplace, mobbing, among others. Mobbing is, do you know what mobbing is? Mobbing is the equivalence of bullying at school. Bullying is at school. Bullying. All right, bullying. And mobbing at the workplace. Next. So the result of the advocacy, what in my opinion, is that the Cuban position on discrimination based, I'm talking about the Cuban government position, based on sexual orientation and gender identity change at the UN many years ago. They were not promoted, those countries from Africa or Middle East that condemn homosexuality, even with death penalty. Cuba are not supporting that anymore, even if they are our friends and they're voting, favoring us against the US blockade resolution and the UN, even that. Because we did it with women's rights. Our government didn't provide any explanation when they did it, and now they are not misbehaving in this issue. The Ministry of Health resolution on transsexual health care that stated in 2008 that transsexual health care is universal, free of charge, and accessible for all trans people, right? And it should, all the procedures for transition should be done in a medical institution. Is that right? That's what it was stated. It was very revolutionary. And also the recognition of sexual orientation as a sort of discrimination by the Cuban Communist Party. So in my opinion, it was a very important change in the political approach to this. Many Cuban Communist Party members were against that decision, of course. But they included that in all the resolutions, and it was prior to the law that it was passed about the labor rights, right? Another one. And as part of this result, it's very interesting what Adela made it. Adela is a male to female trans person, although she considered himself as a homosexual. Okay, I respect that, but she's, Adela is not him, it's him. Okay, right, it's here. And she's a town council woman that was elected by a very poor community in Caibarien in Villa Clara province, right? She was elected and re-elected in the last elections, primary elections that we had in Cuba. She's very supportive of every people there. She has a vibrant way of expressing her rights. She was sent to jail because her father accused her of homosexuality in the 80s. Right? And she was proposed as a, she was nominee, can I say that, not for elections? Nomination, yeah, nominees, yeah. She was, the nomination was made by a member of the Communist Party of the Commission for elections the first time. So many things are changing probably. And she says she wanna be a congresswoman in the future. I hope she will. Next one. What is pending? Okay. a family code bill, or what is called a family law. In Cuba, we have a family law that regulates all family relationships. It was very revolutionary in 1965 when it was issued the first time, but now it do not cover the Cuban, very complex Cuban reality. We are asking for same-sex recognition, adoption, and also trans people rights, and the recognition of lesbians' reproductive rights, because they don't have access to techniques of assisted reproduction and all these techniques to have their own very low cost. They do not need to be expensive, because the problem is not with fertility. The problem is with the system that denies this right to lesbian. So, and also I'm asking myself for sexual rights, reproductive rights for men. What about, how do you say when you're renting, how do you say?
Surrogate.
Thank you. Surrogate pregnancy, can I say that?
Surrogate mother.
What about this? And what about other methods that you can agree with any person? Lesbians sometimes are interesting. There are friends that are heterosexual and can donate the baby to a couple. It happens everywhere, mainly in Western society, developed countries. But in Cuba, it's something we need to promote, because we are far from that yet. No, it's just the gender identity bill that is still to gender identity will recognize gender identity regardless if you have underwent or not sex reassignment surgery. And we are asking for that too. It's still pending. Challenges. Yeah, I just almost finishing. Next. Well, the legal recognition of non-heteronormative sexualities, the implementation of national program on sex education with no gender binary approach and respect to diversity. Do you know what is a binary approach? Masculinity and female, only that. Strengthening the advocacy groups for sexual rights, including non-institutional organizations, is part of the civil society. Intersectional approach against all discriminations, including racial, ethnicity, religious, gender, and economical status grounds, among others. Next. And this is what is gonna happen if we succeeded. We are a lot of still pending. As Jose Marti said when he was speaking about racial issues.
Was that your boyfriend?
No. He's a Cuban national hero. My boyfriend is a hero, but it's not Marti, unfortunately. Oh, Marti, oh my God. Anyway, Marti said, speaking about racial discrimination, everything that divides men, everything that specifies, separates, or pains them is a sin against humanity. Everything. Speaking about race, he covers for the future any grounds of discrimination as we have now in Cuba. Hope we follow Marti the way we have done it in many things in Cuba to succeed in this battle. Thank you very much. Thanks. You want to ask questions?
As we say in Choctaw, Halito, as we say in Cherokee, Osio, both means hello. I'm Reginald Sawyer. I am one of the founding members of the Gay Liberation Network under our original name, Chicago Anti-Bashing Network. I am also the founding member, head founding member of our new Two-Spirit Club at the American Indian Center called the Chicago Two-Spirit Society. And I'm also a member of Pride Alliance at my school, Northeastern Illinois University. Now, I wanted to, because I really enjoyed especially the history about the colonialism that happened to gay people in Cuba. But in my Native American culture, in the ancient times, we didn't have to really worry about all of this, because we as two-spirited people, we were honored and revered for just being ourselves, so just being our real self, and the many roles that we played in all of our tribal societies. So my question to you is, in the ancient time, long before the colonialism came, when the Europeans came to here with colonialism, long before that, did any of the LGBT Cuban people, how were they honored and revered in ancient times?
Okay, no, it hasn't been recorded yet in Cuba that it happened. Actually, what we had in Cuba before the Spaniards came was very small communities of Aboriginal people that came from South America. You know, it's but actually there are a lot of records in South America with the same issue that you're mentioning. I'm very proud to meet someone. There is it's double spirit or two spirit?
Two spirit,
because I found double spirits in like Mohave or other communities in the Navajos or Navajos. I don't know how you say it. I think Navajos. Thank you.
I'm Choctaw Cherokee.
All right, Cherokee.
Yeah, Choctaw and Cherokee.
Yeah, I found that too, and also yeah. All right. And also Inuits in Canada, the Inuit community in Canada, and also the Muches in Huchitan, they have these like two-spirit people, as you call it here. But in Cuba, no, there's not any record. We are a very small island, and they were distributed in different part of the island with small community. We didn't have an empire of in Mexico they had prior to colonization, and also in Peru with the Inca Empire. We were poor since the very beginning, actually, in our ancestors. So you cannot probably make any comparison between what you have here, the Aboriginal people or natives here. Native probably is not a correct way of saying this, but for you, it's not the same history, unfortunately. Probably someone can find, but there are few records, because what the Spaniards did at the very moment was to become these people into Catholic, and they were and they really died. Most of them, they killed them because they didn't suffer. They suffered a lot. They did suffer a lot from discrimination and from exploitation in Cuba. That's the reason why black people came from Africa as slaves. We're sharing that history with the states as well. And that's the reason why we are part Spanish, African, and also Aboriginal in our genes. And Chinese as well, Asian.
So basically what you're saying is that even though the history is kind of different, but the similarities is same with the history of us.
After colonization, colonization. But now when they arrived there, there's not any record. They described more like ethnocentric way of perceiving what they ate, what they hunt. Some of their words are part of our language now in Cuba and the way we speak Spanish. I think in Puerto Rico it happens as well. You have certain words for Aboriginal because it was almost a similar history, which is from Puerto Rico here. Hi. And this is part of a similar history, but I don't think either that in Puerto Rico there is any record of Taínos, yeah. But very small. But in Mexico, they had in different places, and homosexuality was not seen. It was not seen as a very bad issue. It was permitted in certain areas, and some other nations, the way they call it, it was permitted, absolutely permitted.
Before we go any farther, I'd just like to encourage people to make a donation to our wait staff. I'm going to send this can around here. Seriously, the Nookie staff here have been very kind to us. All the food and the drinks here have been free. So let's pass this bucket around. We're going to give the workers of Nookies a good tip, okay? Thank you, and continue with the discussion.
First of all, thank you. You've educated me. You've pushed my envelope a little bit. I have two questions. The first is for Andy. Do you think we can get this gentleman's URL put up on your website?
Yeah.
And he's got your contact information, too.
His contact information here is on the first slide here, and I'm going to put this up here. And this is
And Alberto, you seem to say that the gay community in Cuba may be not the same as the gay community in the United States. There might be differences, nuances, okay? How does that your community respond to the embargo?
LGBT people, I don't speak about community, but for calling a community, you need to have not only common interest concerning your sexuality, but also a political approach to that. And we are not yet that, unfortunately. I have a different concept for a community on the way you have this concept that I really respect very much here in the States. So LGBT Cuban people are, the response to blockade is as any other Cubans. I don't think that we don't have any differences compared to any other individual. We suffer from shortness of goods and shortness of deep economical problems, the access to technology, the access to internet, the access to a lot of things that are necessary to have, let's say, a postmodern life or a life or development as any other country in the world. With our nerd perspective, what is development, actually? Sustainable and in a way we perceive it. Actually, at the same time, the blockade was, in a way, very bad for exchanges between people to know about other experiences. Even for people living in Cuba, to meet people from Europe or from Latin America. Let me tell you that for me it's harder to go to Costa Rica because I'm Cuban than going to the States. If I have a visa, a valid visa to go to the States, I can go with any problem to Costa Rica. But if I don't have it, I cannot do it. I have to ask for a visa. So blockade affects everyone, even in relation with other brother countries. And it happened to me personally. And the way I was seen like a terrorist for immigration in Costa Rica. To Costa Rica. I've been in Canada, and it was good in Canada. But in South America, Cubans are like, oh, if you go to Mexico, you want to go to the States immediately. And so it's a problem related to the blockade, to the misunderstanding in between the countries, to the policy of the blockade, and also aggression of the U.S. government against my country. So that's the point. I think that any Cuban, concerning our rights, it could be very interesting to have exchanges and to create networks, and that everybody is able to do what they would like to do in their own countries with the same perspective. We don't want to change and modify or become the United States in a communist country. We are not communists at all. We are in the transition to socialism. And we don't want to say, okay, but I'm very concerned because you don't have a free healthcare system. I'm very concerned at that because there are humans, a lot of human beings that are suffering. So this is the same issue concerning the blockade. Probably Cuba can share some things to the United States. But it's like Goliath, I said in an interview, and David. Now, with not that bad, relationship, still is bad, by the way. But what could happen if the blockade it doesn't exist anymore? There is another danger for that, is the transformation of the country in a country that we lost the Cuban identity and culture. Even for the gay community, that in Cuba is increasing in a very, for example, in Cuba, most of the gay people and lesbians, mainly gay people, and trans people were asking for places to share, like gay bars and many other places, or at least gay-friendly places. That's right, I think it's good. Okay, now we have it, and they are not concerned about anything else. So the same as what's going on with your life, what's going on with your family, what's going on with you when you are at school, you are at high risk probably to be threatened or abused.
So just like us gay Native Americans, they're more about unifying.
Yeah, that's one of the points, but in my opinion, is beyond this few aspects that are, I think the rights are interconnected. I know it's not only to have, I love to go to a gay bar, but it's sometimes very boring. We prefer to have people from different sexualities and to have exchanges. We don't, I hate, for example, blacks only for, bars only for black people. Why? We should share all spaces. This is a civil right. And this is something that is happening in Cuba, and also following this very globalizing model of what being gay is. Now we are not without any hair anymore. Now we are with the beards and all that, but we are still following all the fashion, very fancy clothes to be a gay, to be recognized. Ah, and forever young. So this is something that is, it could be, the blockade is there, but the people are anxious because of the blockade, because we don't have many things to have access to this. It's pretty wrong sometimes, but you know, it's something that we need to change, in my opinion.
Let's have some of the women speak here.
Oh yes, absolutely.
Muchas gracias, Dr. Guerra. We were so impressed with Cuba. When we were in February, I think it's a very, very unique country in the world in many ways. Your medical system is probably the best in many ways. And also with LGBT rights, you probably are progressing much faster than this country, but that's a low bar. So, my question has to do with meeting some information that I got there from LGBT people who call themselves underground, that felt that Senesex was not answering all their questions. The first complaint was about the police. It's interesting, like we have a problem here with the police. But the police picking up on gay people on the, you know, on Havana, on the beach there, even if they just walk around, charging them with prostitution, putting them in jail, and maybe releasing them the next day, but nonetheless, very penalizing. And Mariela Castro recognized it. She said that they're working on it, but how can we, is it a problem, and how can the police attitudes conform to the general change? Another one was about the availability of antiviral medication for AIDS, and some of it has to do with the embargo, right? Yeah, basically.
No, thank you for reminding me the last part. That also the embargo, but I don't want to focus on HIV infection in LGBT people. I avoid doing that. It's very stigmatizing when you do it. Probably I didn't do it because of that or because I'm tired, but I'm not. But it's something related to the embargo that we don't have access to the latest generation of one pill a day or things like that yet. It's twice a day, it's high efficacy, but it's like you had probably here in the 90s or the beginning of the 21st century. But most of the times, even the medications are not available, they have substitutions, you know, other alternative, because Cuba produces most of the generics medication, and they're given for free of charge, absolutely. And they come and find the generics from India, many other countries, and some of them are produced, manufactured in Cuba. The police issue is still in the way. It's better, in my opinion, in the last years. I mean, the beach is not pretty. You can find sometimes what they are doing is illegal. Homosexuality, as I explained there, is not it's not illegal in Cuba, and the expression. Prostitution is not illegal at all. Not at all. No, not for women, not for men. Although when you're talking about prostitution, everybody immediately would think about a woman. Right? And now to male prostitution that is better, is permitted as a private business. They don't pay any taxes, right, for that. And they do that and they can, they are friends of the police sometimes. I'm not complaining about prostitutes. They're handsome, by the way, some of them. But I'm not complaining about it. These people have the right to work with their body, the same I do with mine, with my hands, and with my stethoscope when I'm at the doctor and things like that. And why not your penis, your tongue, and any other organs or other organs? And it happens, and it's a right. But at the same time, there is an asymmetry between the client and the one who provides the service. It's based on exploitation, and what is underground prostitution, beneath prostitution, is a very bad economical situation most of the times. These guys are coming, all of them, most of them, from the provinces where poorness is higher, when they need to survive to feed their children. And this is something we need to face. CNSX, another institution, are working on researches on this matter. But we need to do it with women, men, regardless of their sexual orientation. With trans people, are still a sex worker because they need to survive, and they only survive at night because when they are cross-dressers during the day, they can be they receive a lot of verbal offenses and things like that and harassment. But actually, the hate crimes are pretty low in Cuba. It happens, but not in a high way. It's very safe for most of the people, fortunately. So with the police, I've been training policemen, and they realize this is wrong. But the problem is when you have a policeman that is pretty young, coming from provinces with a lot of prejudice and very macho, as a soldier with power, so you can imagine what happened. Start doing things, the day after they don't have charges, because they don't have charges. Prostitution is not illegal. So this is something that we need. We need to be, in my opinion, we have delayed a lot to do something to improve the situation.
And what about teenage
lines? Sorry, again.
No, just the third issue I forgot was the teenage runaways. Teenage runaway. They had to leave home.
Oh, okay. You mean gay people?
Yes.
Yeah, it happens. It could be in Cuba. Teenagers, let me tell you that most of children in Cuba are protected. It's illegal to fire someone from your family, because when you are a child up to you are 18 years old, if you do it, that's illegal. It's pretty weird for teenagers to leave their homes. They can have problems. It could happen in certain families, dysfunctional families. The term is very tricky, but it's, I think all family has dysfunctions, but it's just, anyway. But it's very dysfunctional families with poverty, a lot of problems in Cuba economies, transversalizing the whole country, as happens everywhere, but in this reason, in this setting, it's in about impact. And it could happen, but it's pretty weird, because they have to go to school. It's obligated to send them to school. And immediately, all the community organizations are there. What's happening with your... Of course, we have criminals that are teenagers. It happens. Of course, there are teenagers that probably they committed suicide because they are homosexual. This is a very bad problem. And we are aware that it happens in Cuba. But it's not a major issue. Probably it's hidden. I don't know. But it's not very common to hear that it happens. It's more common when you are a young man or a young woman and you are not understood in your family. In Cuba, we are like three or four generations living together. So you can imagine, because of the housing problems that we have. Yeah. Do you want us to let the people?
Alberto, I have two questions. What was the motivation for the recriminalization of homosexuality? For that's my first question. I believe it was in 1987. And my first thought is that it's linked up with the AIDS epidemic. Which was what, the first case was diagnosed in
1985.
Okay. Second question is, the state of Illinois just recently has basically, it's outlawed reparative therapy, conversion therapy. Do you know what I'm speaking about?
Yeah.
It's done that for, it's now illegal for children under 18 to be treated in the state of Illinois. Is it legal in, is conversion therapy legal in Cuba? And if not, when was it made illegal?
Very interesting questions. Actually, in the, I don't know exactly the reason why. I asked some lawyers that are working in these issues, and they said that we had a very, very strong impact of the law status from the Soviet Union at that moment, still. And Cuba took a lot of examples. It was legal in the Soviet Union. We were following, actually in the 70s and the 80s, we were following the Soviet model, copying a lot of things from the Soviet model. It could be one of the reasons, but I say it could be. I'm not sure. I need that research should be made to find out. I probably have interviewed with the people who were in charge of the Ministry of Justice at that moment to know why they recriminalized homosexuality. I am not very sure that AIDS was part of this issue. It could be, but probably was another issue. But they were trying to control in the streets, mainly in the 23rd Street in Havana, in main city capitals, main capitals of provinces, these people gathering in the streets because they were occupying, actually, public spaces like Coppelia Ice Cream Parlor, or also in the Malecon area, the tea house. We had tea house in Cuba. And it was very common for gay gathering there having tea. It was very British, or I don't know. It's we keep it doing like that. But it's part of this. And what you said in Cuba, reparative treatments are forbidden since the 1960s. Because it was done, probably, let me tell you, even electrical therapy, or, you know, electroshockers were applied for cure homosexuality. I had a review from the a journal of the psychiatric hospital in Cuba. There is a center, the National Center of Reference for Psychiatry, of some publications of treatment in the 60s. Bill Mespingijua ordered to stop that in the 60s. Later, the psychologists and psychiatrists were counseling, giving support, wider behavioral changes, but not reparative treatment on trying to cure anything. Psychoanalysis, okay, I will say something wrong. Psychoanalysis was not a very strong specialty in Cuba on mental for treating people or evaluating people. It's been more, as an option in the 90s, so there was not any treatment. Probably counseling, probably from this very old perspective that you can have your kid and go to baseball games, things like that. It's very, conductive, I think it's, or behavioral treatments that they apply to many other disorders not related to homosexuality. I'm talking as if I were before it was removed from the mental disorder list, right? That's the answer to the questions. All right.
Yeah.
Another who was over here.
Woman right over
all
here.
Right.
I would like to know when gay people were allowed to go to the universities, and also I would like to know if they have any gay people in parliament. Any comment? Fidel Castro couldn't have been an anti gay person because his best friend was Guevara, and Guevara was openly gay. Oh, he was not openly gay. Everybody knew, but everybody knew that he was gay, and he was his best friend. They were in Belen.
Absolutely.
From my records, I think it was in the 80s. There was another, like a reform of the universities again, and homosexuals were prohibited, but it was relaxing in the second part of that decade of the 1980s. In the night, it was pretty weird that someone was fired from the university for being gay.
Well,
in the 90s, it was pretty weird to have that. They were, we had access to the university as a universal system without any problem for gay people. It could happen certain discrimination. Trans people were discriminated, actually, for being trans people. They were not allowed to cross-dress at the university. Still is a problem. But that's the reason why you don't see very college graduate students or professionals that are trans people. And they have access to other basic education. Most of them cross-dressing because CNSX is doing a lot of work, a lot of demands, legally speaking, educating these professors to say, okay, you should allow them. But I think after, in the second half of the 80s, the situation improved concerning rights to study at all levels of the educational system, excepting trans people. That the situation is improving in the last 3 or 4 years, actually. When I was at CNSX, I remember a lot of problems with transsexual people that were under transition, complaining because they have problems at school, not from their peers, from their colleagues, but from the professors. Power is power.
There were some hands up right here. No, I just wanted to know, is racism still a problem in Cuba? Is racism still a problem?
It is the same as homophobia. And the problem with racism, racism is prohibited by the Constitution in many articles, even including hate, stimulating hate because it's part of our history and it's a very painful part of our history. But the problem is that they thought that doing that in the Constitution and in the Penal Code was done. And a debate about racism was, how can I say that? It was put off.
Put on the back burner.
And it was like Pandora cage. Can I say that in English?
The Pandora box.
The Pandora box, okay, was closed. So now there is a lot of concerns about that. And the historical memory is very important during the Republic. A lot of black people, the bourgeois Republic in 1912, were assassinated during the Republic. That it was racial discrimination was supposedly illegal, but it happened. And we're coming back to Los Independientes de Color, Independence of Color. There is a book there. Read up that book, is very, Esteban Morales is a very good researcher on this matter. And now we are discussing that only in academic spaces, in few spaces, but not in the way that I would like to, with the community, with the people, openly about racial discrimination. On television recently, there has been like 4 or 5 debates, changing opinion about that. In Cuba, the, how do you call the survey for demographic survey, census? It's the same in Spanish. The census, Cubans, you declare how you identify yourself. And most of Cubans are whites. Do you believe that? I'm not white. No race, I have many races. I have everything in that, multivariance racial person. So this is something that is expressed, that the problem is not to be black, the problem is whiteness. Everybody, most of the people would like to be whites because their asymmetries still persist. And it's structural because you see it, although it's illegal, you go to, most of our leaders are white. If you go to a hospital on the tertiary level that is very specialized, patients and doctors, most of them are whites.
Even when you do the Mayday, the majority of the soldiers are white.
All right, this is something, but if you go to sport area, most of them are black. And if they are dancers, most of them are black. So, I beg your pardon? Musicians, it depends. If it is classic music, not. And in the ballet, we have a lot of black people, but not necessarily so. We need to change. It's a very cultural, still a cultural issue that needs to be modified. And we need to interconnect that with homophobia, misogynist, misogynism on other discriminatory grounds.
So you all Cubans just the same, be it your dark Cuban or light-skinned Cuban, you all Cubans just the same, Latinos.
Yeah, and I don't consider myself Latino, but it's... What is that? I'm Cubano, and that's all. And we have the different way of being Cubans, all right.
And they tend to be the poor as well in Cuba?
Yeah, it could be because it's class. Yeah, it's related to class as well. And if you are a lesbian, a transgender person living in Eastern provinces, poor, undergraduate, because you are probably 9th grade of scholarship, no, it's education level, you'll be gonna suffer a lot. That's what I tried to explain as an example, and it happens if you have all the conditions together. Conditions in a good manner, in a good way.
I have a few questions. So you mentioned non-binary people. Something I'm really curious about is, since in the Spanish language everything is so gendered, todo termina con o o o a.
Very complicated.
What words do you use for somebody who wants to use like they, them pronouns in the English language? To use usted, or like, is that respected there in Cuba? No.
No. Yeah, even for scholars, it's pretty hard. They have this act of using this asterisk, how do you say that?
Asterisk.
Yeah, asterisk. Yes, to not mention gender, but it's pretty hard. Mm-hmm. Language is a way of exerting power, mm-hmm. and it's expressive culture, and it's necessary to be changed and modified, mm-hmm. and find new words.
Yeah.
In Cuba, we are very good at it,
mm-hmm.
finding new words for new expressions and new things.
Is there a word there that you use in Cuba for, that would be an equivalent of queer here, that's like an umbrella term for non-heteronormative, I guess?
Well, queer has been recently in the States like an identity.
Right.
In Spain, you already have purposes. It used to be in the 90s as non-classifiable, non-labeling people.
Uh-huh.
I mentioned myself as a queer person, but it could be considered a lot of practices, genders in the same time, and fluidity due to my whole life experience.
Mm-hmm.
In Cuba, I've met people who identify themselves queer, but I do not agree when they try to call that an identity, because it's against the original concept of what a queer person is.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reason why when we say you are queer, this English, Anglo, you know, speaking term, for example, you can say torcido, but it's very discriminatory, or there is another term that was invented in Latin America that is encuriar. Encuriar.
Mm-hmm.
That is similar to encuerar, to be without clothes,
uh-huh.
and labels. Encuriar. But it's an invention.
Uh-huh.
But in Cuba, there is not, still we are very gender binary. We have a gender binary bias,
uh-huh.
for everything.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Also, I was at CENESEX this summer, and I went to Cuba for like a few weeks, and they mentioned, we were talking about gender reassignment surgeries, and Tanya had mentioned that that there's only been like 28 people in Cuba to ever have a gender reassignment surgery. And I was wondering why that number was so low, since it is free, and I would imagine there's more trans people than that in Cuba. Why do you think that is? She didn't really know.
I just wondering what she's gonna say. Okay, the waiting list for sex reassignment surgery is not that long, because many people hasn't completed the transition yet. In Cuba, still we have these standards of care that you need to prove in front of a doctor that you have another identity, and I do not agree that. I have a depathologizing approach on that. That you have to have access, and there are other people that are actually very dysphoric because they suffering from certain symptoms and they need a health care from, you know, mental health care it happens for many of them because they suffer discrimination. Gender dysphoria doesn't exist. Dysphoria is because they are discriminated by the society. This is my perspective. I defended that when I was in the commission. I'm not working with them anymore, but I'm just advocating to change that anyway. And inside, although there is another reason, surgeries, they're a little bit expensive, not that much compared to other surgeries in Cuba. I have all the calculations for that and the amount of money. The problem is for the system, not for the people. The problem is that Cuban surgeons have not been trained up properly yet to have the first surgery and to do it in our country. So doctors, surgeons from Belgium are coming to Cuba to training, and they are not ready because it's a long process. You have to do a lot of surgeries to be trained or to be qualified to do that surgery because it's very complex. It's like a cosmetic. I don't like the term surgery. Most of them should be plastic surgeons. And they've been doing that since 2007 when the operation started again. The first one was 1988, the only one, with another technique. But now it's different because of the US blockade in the 90s and the crisis, they have to stop doing their surgeries. That's another reason. And some others, trans people are not interested in surgery. They just interested in some psychological counseling and hormonal treatment, and that's it.
Right, which is what the bill is fighting for, right?
The bill is going to be something just to... We doctors are not gatekeepers. Mm-hmm. We support people. We provide counseling and help. But individually, concerning your own needs, yours and yours, it's not like everybody is following the same model and avoiding paternalistic approach that is violating your human rights.
Hi, my name is Dinal Mario Kopp, and I'm a senior at UIC and applying to grad school in biological sciences, so I do a lot of sex research. Biological sciences, and I do a lot of sex research, and I speak six languages, so I do a lot of international activism. Okay, and so I had a question regarding like the scientific research that you mentioned. Like, you were a member of an organization that deals with studies on sexuality. If you could like elaborate on that, and also the second part of the question was, do you have any kind of ties to South American LGBT groups? And just if you could elaborate on that. And just quickly, I wanted to answer, who was it that you asked about gendered speech in language? When I lived in Germany, they were in the process of changing the language as far as like feminism was concerned, because all the terms were masculine, so like student was studenten, you know, and then they changed it. So now they include the masculine and the feminine. And so that's like one possible approach that could be done in the Spanish-speaking countries or in France or something.
Your first question was about the Cuban Multidisciplinary Society for the Study of Sexuality. It's a long name, SOCUMES. SOCUMES was created, was founded in 1986. And it's, as its name, as acronym says, is a multidisciplinary society of professionals. It belongs to the civil society in Cuba. It's non-governmental, with a lot of specialists on medicine, psychologists, psychiatrists, physical therapy specialists as well. Who else? Lawyers are members of this society, and also sociologists, anthropologists, people specialize in demography, religious organizations that are linked to the society, providing specialists on theology. Okay. And then a lot of connections is multidisciplinary. My approach is interdisciplinary, to speak a little bit about everything and not be an expert of anything. And trying to modify things on a way to, the society has different sections, mine is sexual diversity, and now when I come back to Cuba, I'm going to have a nomenclature section concerning all the pathologizing approach in medicine for sexuality and gender. It's more than transsexuality. Paraphilic people, chronic pelvic pain. There are a lot of diseases that are pathologized by the DSM. Do you know what a DSM is? Everybody knows here, right? It's the imperialistic approach of psychiatrists from the U.S. to the worldwide, labeling people. This is a manual for studies. It's a statistic manual for diagnosis of psychiatric disorders. They don't even agree what a mental disorder is, and they are labeling a lot of diseases. The first one was that big, and the last one is like this. Version 5. We are going crazy here. So this is a point that I want to do. We have another section for sexual medicine that is related to disturbances related to erection, libido, and sexual desire. So there is multidisciplinary. We are in groups for family studies. So it's sort of the legal, you know, lawyers are everywhere. There they are, and we are interconnecting the way we are doing. Now we have a Congress, by the way, it's taking place. I'm here in the state, but someone will read my paper about sexual citizenship. And the our panel, we have a religious person, a lawyer, a psychologist, and myself, the medical doctor. Just for you to be aware about I'm very proud of my society. We do a lot of work and also advocacy work. And your question, the other one was to?
Ties to South America.
Oh yeah, absolutely. With the most of the countries, because we are members, SOCUMES and CENESEX and other organizations of the Latin American, it's the Gay and Lesbian and Trans Association. For Latin America and the Caribbean, ILGALAC, big names. ILGALAC. ILGA is International Lesbian and Gay Association worldwide. It's like an umbrella organization. And from the region of the Caribbean, we have Latin America and the Caribbean and North America. Mexico is North America, but for historical reasons, are members of ILGALAC, right? So we are connected with many of them. In my case, Guatemala, Peru, Ecuador, Argentina, Brazil, and Chile. Most of them. And Venezuela, of course, we have been there also, and Nicaragua. No, I met some of the lawyers, but not with the organizations. But with the lawyers and activists, yes, I know some of them. So, and this is increasing. And in Cuba, they celebrated one of the summits 2 years ago for the Latin American region in Baradero Beach.
Okay,
yeah.
I think we'll have like one or two more questions about these two gentlemen.
Okay. I have two questions again. Okay, the first question is about gay marriage. You haven't touched on that in Cuba. The second question is about this breakthrough in the U.S. opening its embassy in Havana, and the reciprocity of a Cuban embassy opening here in D.C. Pope Francis was very instrumental in helping this along, and my question is, the Cuban bishops have recently found courage to start speaking out on sexual mores. Does that concern you?
Yeah. Your questions are pretty hard. Okay, gay marriage in Cuba. The first bill, or at least the first draft to be a bill in the future for family relationships, marriage was not included. Only in the last few months, something has been said that the proposal is progressively to discuss, to have a debate about gay marriage as such. I do not support marriage personally, but I will fight with all my members, my limbs and everything, to have access for everyone. I was talking to a friend here about that. Yeah, there he is. and then I do not support marriage because it's following all the gender approach and the gender asymmetries from heterosexual, and this is not enough following this. I've been with my partner for 17 years, and we have another kind of relationship. And we both have been very, very careful in keeping this way, changing with our practices and our experiences in a very versatile way, in all senses. And then it's as such. This is the way we do it, and we share that experience with young people, not following this very schematic way of relationship at home with the family, based on marriage. But if marriage allows you to have more rights, that is going to happen in Cuba, fine. Let me tell you that for heterosexual in Cuba, marriage is not that important. People are not getting married very often. And their rights are guaranteed anyway. But we do not exist, and he said something that is right, and I think about that many years ago. What if my partner dies? The family will be like sharks around me. Okay, oh, if it's my case, mine too, believe me, they will do it. So this is something that still, in the meanwhile, I'm fighting against marriage as an ideology invented by patriarchal power and liberalism after the church lost power. Then my opinion is that we need to take what you have and go move forward. Okay, making modifications and also with the law. The second question, so I forgot it, is about the approaching of, okay, then Pope Francis is coming after the coming to Cuba. Yeah, he's been a little bit confusing in his statements on about homosexuality in the last months or years. But it's very interesting. This is a very progressive Pope. I think he's in danger in the first place. And also, he's been very open to consider gender equality from a very Catholic perspective. I do not agree, but speaking about gender equality, a pope, I beg your pardon, this is something brand new, and we need to watch carefully. This is my approach. I'm just wondering what is going to happen in Cuba when he goes there. And I wanted to check his speeches about what is going on. And I think it's going to be more on the political issue and the understanding between governments. And I really appreciate what he did. He's a very progressive pope. And probably the church will change in the future about that. Yeah, we live in a moment that women are not burned for being witches. Finally, we changed that. So I hope that in the future, the church will also change their perspective. Because I have a lot of books about the Bible, and it's not stated anything about homosexuality. And I have a lot of evidence that actually in Cuba we have a lot of progressive groups fighting against homophobia that are religious. When Mariela Castro was discussing the law, the labor law, the parliament, the two members of parliament that follow Mariela are representatives, are officials from Protestant churches, saying that they were supporting Mariela in public. So something is moving. They do not belong to the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church in Cuba is powerful, but only 10 or 20% of Cubans are Catholic. Right? So it's a different approach. Watch carefully what they're doing.
I'll try to make it as brief as possible. I don't know how brief the answer will be. In terms of politics, as you know, in America, we don't have a lot of diversity in terms of the party system we have, and socialism has been a dirty word. You mentioned moving from communism to socialism. Is there anything, any insights you want to share with us about politics in Cuba today and where you think things are going? What does the political landscape look like going forward?
Political scape in general, you mean? Not in LGBT politics?
Well, that's another question. Who are the natural allies, like you mentioned?
are beyond. I think it's in Cuba, everything is changing. The political aspects are changing within the Communist Party, slowly, but it's changing. And I think it's gonna, political issues are more attached to economical changes now. It's a national security issue, economy, of course. It happens everywhere. We need to improve it, we need to have better opportunities in the future, economically speaking. And political changes in the way we make politics will change, definitely. The leaders will be not there anymore of the revolution. They are getting older. Fidel is still alive. He's going to be the leader for many, many years. A lot of followers, independently of what is happening or not in the future, because I'm not Nostradamus to say what is going to happen in Cuba. It's a very complex issue. But politically speaking, I think that we are going to improve in participation, in having a more horizontal approach on politics, a political participation in Cuba that we had at the beginning of the revolution, and we have left with institutionalization by the state of many things in Cuba. The approach from Raul is different, and this, for me, is a political change. And even the so-called freedom of speech and all that, if you want to see freedom of speech, go in a Cuban bus in Havana early in the morning, people complaining of everything and everyone. And they are not going to jail, and they are going to know to UMAPs or anything like that, right? The country is changing. On television, you see a different pattern of discussion. Still, the media is pretty bad. The media is representing a country that do not exist. It's improving, but it's not, it's not enough. So this is my perspective of many colleagues that believe in my country, in a different nation, improving the country, are rescuing values that we have lost because of the crisis and many other reasons, and making politics in a different way in the future. This is inventing our own model of socialism, or not a model, our own way of doing things, because model is like it's very restrictive to prescribe or normative. That's it.
Okay, let's give a hand for Alberto Roque Guerra.